Phil was no more an ordinary person than James Joyce or William Blake were ordinary people, or Marilyn Monroe was an ordinary person either. Phil was an extraordinary person. And he had some super extraordinary experiences.
The unknown side of Phil is that he probably was a philosopher in a world where philosophy has pretty much been replaced by technology. You know, we got science now. What do we need philosophy for? We can find out what works and what's real, and nobody really needs to speculate about it. If you want to be a philosopher, you go be a physicist, you know. But Phil was a traditional classical philosopher, you know, and maybe one of the last.
He was so damn funny. I mean, even when things were terrible, he was funny. I had a slip disc in 1980, and I was bedridden, and we talked on the phone all the time then, and I told him I reread all his books, and he said, "Miriam, that's just crazy. That when you're all taking pain pills and you're in pain and everything, reading my books, they're very upsetting books, you know." I said, "I know they are, Phil, but I feel very comforted by your voice with me." And he said, "Well, that'll be all right then."
The readers who discover Philip K. Dick, I think, almost universally identify with the characters in his novels and the way that the author apparently feels compassionately about these characters and these situations that the characters are faced with, including the familiar theme of their doubts about what's really going on.
The kind of human situations that he presents are still happening. And the things that happen in his mainstream novels, they could be happening right now. The crises that people are facing, are the crises that people are facing right now. And he's almost unique in the science fiction world. Ray Bradbury is the only other name that comes to mind of a writer who remains current by never having been in.
I think people still read Phil Dick because partly it's the characters. The characters really, he was very good at capturing conflicts between people, having complex characters with, you know, more neuroses than you could count on your both hands, and they're just compelling, you know, and they were struggling with the moral questions that a lot of us confront in life, you know. Is the universe ultimately benign or not? You know, is it a trap?
I do try to turn people on to Philip K. Dick on a regular basis, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. There's people out there that don't want to see all the possibilities in the world. They don't want to know, they don't want to explore the truth on every different dimension. You know, they want to accept things the way that they are just because it's easier.
My housemates and I in college, we watched Star Trek pretty much every afternoon, and our favorite episodes were the holodeck episodes where they had the whole mind trip of are we on the holodeck, have we ever left the holodeck, and you know, what's real, what's not real. And he said, "Well, if you like this, you're gonna love, you should really read Philip K. Dick, and it's much more intense, it's gonna blow your mind."
In 1994, I think it was, somebody put up on internet a report of my death, and no matter how much I've denied it, it seems most people accept that I'm still alive, but there's a diehard minority who insists I'm dead and the CIA has replaced me with an android. And I'd be much happier if I never read Phil Dick, because I would just think, well, I know I'm not an android, but having read Phil Dick, I realized if I was an android properly constructed, I think I am Robert Anton Wilson. So that leaves me perpetually in the predicament of not being sure whether I'm Robert Anton Wilson or an android program to think it's right, to think, talk, and write like Robert Anton Wilson. I guess I'm really grateful to Phil for that. It gives me a certain agnostic detachment, which I think is necessary for mental health.
My favorite book of his, I think, was Time Out of Joint, which in many ways is one of his most minor books. But to me, it just had these classic moments where, you know, he's riding on the bus and, you know, he gets the glimpse that everything else on the bus is a prop, you know. And that seemed to sum up some weird truth that I couldn't quite put my finger on.
I think really what he wanted to do was use the typewriter as a medium to digest what he knew about life and how to make some sense out of it. He could collect things in his brain and sort facts around like playing cards and then deal them back out in a novel. He said, well, does that make sense? Is that a worldview that I can live with? No, but at least it's a novel.
He was always a champion of the underdog, and he was a champion of the salesman because the salesman was an underdog. So he would have underdog heroes constantly in his stories. It would not be the captain of the space patrol, and it would not be the Empress of Mars. It would be some repairman or some alcoholic or some obscure person would almost always be the central figure. And he felt that these ordinary people that he saw around him, they had been really shortchanged in the science fiction field, and that real stories could be written about people who were not the kings and queens of their particular universe.
One of the personal things about Phil that that struck me was he was a big man, big, heavy, barrel-chested, tall, imposing presence. And I really got the intense perception, a real strong feeling from Phil, that he knew that he intimidated people, and that he knew that he consciously had to do everything he could to make them feel at ease because he had the tendency to intimidate them. And I thought, boy, that is, you know, just the sense that this radiated from him really speaks volumes about the man. You can, you know, you understand something about him without even a word being exchanged, just through the way that he treats you, just through the way that he would communicate with people and interact with them, that he was making every effort he could not to be intimidating, and to be, you know, as good a listener and as intelligent a communicator as he could possibly be.
He had a wry, often self-deprecating humor, which was also very flattering. I mean, when you're talking to Philip K. Dick, and you can get a little of this, I think, on the tape recording that the Philip K. Dick Society put out as an issue of the newsletter. Which includes some of the conversations, little pieces of the conversations that Phil and I had when we were taping the interviews for the Rolling Stone article. I think that in listening to that, it's possible to hear the way the man talked and the essential humor in the way that he would talk, well, to anyone, but particularly to his friends. And I say it's flattering because there's an implication that you are smart enough and present enough to pick up on this subtlety in what he's saying. And then you both look at each other and grin or laugh.
Phil, there's something I've been meaning to ask you for years. In your stories, there is an enormous amount of cigarette smoking. People are always lighting up or putting out cigarettes. Yet I've never seen you smoke. What? Tell me something about that. And he said, well, Marion, There's sex in my stories, too.
So everybody's just cracking up and rolling on the floor. And and just then, Chester Anderson arrived, and everybody's roaring with laughter, and he says, "I want to hear, I want to hear. Come on, do it again." And Phil said, and Paul said, "Okay, okay, instant replay, instant replay. I'll be Miriam. Phil, there's a lot of cigarette smoke." And he said it just real silly. "There's a lot of cigarette smoke." And so what have you got to say about that? And Phil said, "I really couldn't say."
I think all around us, our friends are doing things, and we what they do is similar to what we do, maybe even identical to what we do. And we presume, we make presumptions about why they do it. And there's no reason to assume, you know, that they're doing it for the same reason. In other words, you and I sitting here, neither of us being nuts, neither of us exhibiting bizarre behavior, would assume that if I was in your mind and you were in my mind, we were switching around, we'd see things the same, we'd perceive the world the same way, and so forth. It's not really true. This is not really a philosophical question. It's a very real question.
Mystery in the life of Philip K. Dick that still hovers around is the break-in in 1971. And there are many different stories, none of which really make sense about that break-in. I first learned about it when he phoned me in a panic and said that somebody had blown his safe and made off with very precious personal items.
Maybe drugs, maybe tax records, or but it's a little unknown, but apparently he came home one day and found that the safe had been blown up. And I think this is kind of crazy, but he called the cops and got the police involved in this, which is really, you know, pretty amusing because of all the drug activity that was in the house and his paranoia of the authorities and all the stuff that, I mean, I think it's a real sign of a, you know, a little bit of a split personality that he would bring the police into this issue.
Phil, in talking to me, and as quoted in my book, says the police thought maybe he did it himself. And Phil was charmed by that idea. It made for good telling. And then, being Philip K. Dick, he could ask himself, well, is it possible I did it myself and I forgot, you know? Let's see, what would my motivation have been? And so forth and so on. I mean, as a novelist, he could take off from anywhere and go somewhere unexpected with it.
I think it's fascinating to contemplate, did he, you know, engineer his own break-in? You know, I mean, to me, that's the most entertaining of all the options. You know, he concocted it himself. Sort of like in a Scanner Darkly, you know, you're busting yourself and you don't even realize it. But I think it is possible that there was either some sort of Marin drug-related aspect to it, or that there might have been a political motive, and you know, it could have been part of COINTELPRO. It's a little far-fetched. He wasn't that directly involved politically with things, but the more that comes out about that era and even the 50s, the FBI just kept an eye on a lot of people, and you know, that's a possibility.
I had seen that safe open, and what I thought was in that safe was a plastic bag full of white powder, which I believed, he never said what it was, but I believed that it was heroin. And I believed that it was heroin because at that point he had met another person that I'd rather not name, but I'll call him The Connection. He had met The Connection. And The Connection was a fellow who sold drugs for a living, and a very good living he made at it too, but he was also a poet, and he published a little literary review, and he was in with the Beatniks. He was in with William Burroughs, because he supplied William Burroughs. He was in with Allen Ginsberg. He was in with all these literati that Phil admired.
Behind me is the Marin County Civic Center. It was designed by Frank Lloyd Wright. Sometime in the 60s, you may recognize it as the used in the film Gattaca as the Rocket Academy. The administrative offices for the area are in here, the courthouse, the fire department, police department, most importantly, because these are the, this is where Philip K. Dick was calling all the time, practically on speed dial. He had him, he was calling him and saying, you know, my safe's been blown up, there's people in my yard, you know, there's people are out to get me. So this is where he was calling. And when Paul Williams was writing his piece for Rolling Stone about the break-in, he came here to this building to try and find the records, and he was denied access to them for whatever reason.
Since Phil and I, like other people on the street in the United States, knew about a lot of, or had read about, a lot of the things that had gone on around the Watergate incidents. Watergate originally was a break-in. And then there were other break-ins where attempts to get information about somebody who might have some information about somebody who'd given money to the Democratic Committee or to the Republican Committee and so forth. And then there was a break-in at a psychiatrist's office, supposedly by the plumbers who were working on the direction ultimately of Richard Nixon. So it's easy to see how this context, which was very real, and things like this did happen in the early and mid-1970s in California and in the United States, how this would fuel the imagination of Philip K. Dick and, of course, of the readers of Rolling Stone.
My theory on Paul Williams' article was that he tried to use the break-in as a metaphor for the multiple realities of Philip K. Dick. You know, one event can have numerous interpretations if you don't really know what happened. You know, a mystery can be parsed out in any number of ways. And, you know, this kind of imaginative fantasy built on an actual event was kind of how Phil wrote his books.
Phil, at that point, was in another one of his dry spells, and he was taking out his earnings for 1 year, and Mr. Connection said, "Oh, I'd make more than that in 1 week." And Phil said, "Really? Well, what does it take to get into your line of work?" And at this point, Phil had a group of drug-oriented teenagers camping in his house. And Mr. Connection was using him as an intermediary for a thriving drug distribution business.
It looks pretty nice now, but I guess at the time this was a real sketchy neighborhood of sorts. He lived here with just a really, sounds like a musical housemates of oddball characters, mostly I think the whole uniting factor was taking a lot of speed.
See, this is a guy who had befriended and kind of had an open house for the young drug users, the kids who were burned out using speed and other drugs in this small town environment in Northern California, close to San Francisco, in the beginning of the 1970s. And these young people knew that you could go to this guy's house and he might let you crash there. or you could ask him questions, and he'd talk and talk, you know, and he was taking Benzedrine, Benny's, and you could get some from him sometimes, you know, if you listened to him telling his stories or whatever, you know. So he had this strange relationship as a man who, at that time, was over 40 anyway, relationship with teenagers at a very volatile time, even for Marin County, California, who would, who knew that his house was a place you could go to and run into other kids and hang out and even maybe crash if you needed a place to crash.
And what I think happened was that one of those girls, the one that he called the dark-haired girl, and that he professed to be madly in love with, I think that she was in love or associated with the drug suppliers. And she persuaded them to give Phil some drugs on credit, which he had in the safe. But then she and her friends blew the safe and took the drugs and left him owing the gangsters for the drugs. And almost immediately there, almost the first thing he did was phone the FBI and tell them a partly true story about what was in the safe.
Phil never suggested to me that he thought, that the FBI thought he was involved in some direct subversive activity. But he thought that they might have suspected it because possibly something he'd said in a novel he'd written was too close to a description of a real secret project. And this has happened in the history of science fiction too, where the FBI came to knock on the door of the editor of a science fiction magazine because he'd published something that made them think that maybe he had inside information about the atom bomb project that was supposed to be top secret. Well, it really wasn't new to science fiction, but the story was so detailed that it made somebody at the FBI or somewhere decide that they should investigate this. So again, Philip K. Dick, he pointed, if I remember right, specifically to his novel, The Penultimate Truth, and thought that maybe there was something that a hypothesis he'd come up with that was just too close to home.
After that, he began to make plans to leave, rapidly making plans to leave. And he left and went to Canada and entered a drug rehabilitation program
in Vancouver called Ex-Calais, which was primarily there, as Synanon was originally, to help heroin addicts or recovering addicts. And Phil joked about the fact that he had to sort of deceive them into thinking that he was a drug user, which he was. He'd been an amphetamine user for years and years, so he could just expand on that. But because he needed help and he had the idea that these people could help him somehow, he tried to disguise himself as somebody who would fit their parameters, that they could help him because he was suicidally depressed and at loose ends and whatever. And so to him, it was a good joke that he had to pretend to be a drug user in order to get help.
He thought going to Canada, he would escape from these gangsters that he owed money to, and that it's not a good idea to owe money to those people. But almost immediately, they found him in Canada. He was coming out of Ex-Calais. He wrote me a letter about it. He was coming out of Ex-Calais, and there he saw a man in a suit that was just a little too good. And the fellow in the suit said, you know, sooner or later, one way or another, we all have to pay our debts, Phil. So Phil was absolutely beside himself. He thought they were going to kill him. And so that cured him of any interest that he might have had in drugs thereafter.
I remember one time I went down to the motor vehicle to renew my license, and this is always very traumatic for me because I don't want to take the driving test because I know what I'll do when I take the driving test. I know how many people I will run over and everything. So I must pass the written test so that I don't have to take the driving test. And then I get very frightened by this written test. So you could make I think what, 5 errors and stuff. So I went up to the girl with my, you know, answers, and I handed it to her, and she was grading it, and I said to her, if I do not pass this test, I am going to kill myself.
Felt so depressed that he tried to kill himself by taking an overdose of potassium bromide or something like that. And he, as a result of that, he didn't die.
There was a poet that we both discussed sometimes. His name was George Sterling, and he committed suicide with a cyanide cap at the Bohemian Club in San Francisco. And Phil and I, and in fact most science fiction people, admire George Sterling for his fantasy poetry. And the way Phil put it in his letter, he said, I almost pulled a George Sterling. But he didn't get clinical about it. And it's hard to say whether he actually made an attempt or just set himself up for it and didn't do it. Because George Sterling had carried a cyanide cap with him for decades, and he carried it in his pocket. And when people asked him about that pill, he would take it out and he says, how did that phrase go? He said, a prison becomes a home if you have the key.
After the break-in at the end of 71 and going to Canada and the events that happened there in early 72, he moved to Orange County, California, where he lived for the rest of his life.
This is the University Archives and Special Collections section of the Pollack Library at California State University Fullerton, and we house about 88 different collections of rare books and related materials. And one of the most important collections that we have is our science fiction manuscript collection. And the jewel in our crown of our science fiction manuscript collection is the Philip K. Dick collection. And when a reader comes into the section, we have them sign in. We then take our science fiction archives and manuscript binder to the table. We have them look through it, select the boxes that they would like to look in. We then page the boxes for them from our closed stacked area. And then they may use the materials here in the section. They may make Xerox copies as appropriate. And if there's any research assistance or background information that we can provide, we will do that also. This is the service binder listing all of our Philip K. Dick material. So we'll go to the appropriate section of the binder. And we have some introductory material, a little background information about the collection. Then a very detailed list of the various manuscripts that we own here at California State University Fullerton. Then we go on to some short story materials by Mr. Dick, and then some specialized materials of correspondence and critical commentary, book review material. And then finally, we finish up with a list of published editions, hardback and paperback, of his writings. And once our patron has made a selection of which boxes they would like to look at, I would proceed into our closed stack area to retrieve that box and to bring it to the table for our patron to use. As you can see, this is the stacks and special collections, and where we house our materials. We call it Never Never Land sometimes because our patrons never come back here. We page the materials for them and take them out to the reading room. Aisles 8 and 9 are the areas where we have our special collections for science fiction materials, and specifically the Philip K. Dick collection. And as you can see, we've even noted his name as one of the more prominent collections that we have. It is indeed one of the most used collections that we have of all of our special collections. These are the actual stacks and shelves that house the Philip K. Dick manuscript materials. We have a series of archival boxes that we house the original typescripts and Matt Carbon copies and setting copies of his various writings. And then we continue on with slightly more personal materials of correspondence, biographical material, and critical commentary on his works. And then right at the midsection and onto the bottom, we have published editions of his various works in paperback and hardback.
One of the things that I have always noticed is that many people equate insanity with extravagant behavior. That is, where someone is shouting or being very violent, you know, very impassioned. But that if something is done very calmly and dispassionately, that this is rational, that rational and dispassionate are somehow synonymous, and that a person who speaks in a modulated voice, in a calm voice, is ipso facto a rational person. Someone who screams, you know, shouts, cries, you know, gets very terrorist, rends his garments. This is a typical Anglo-Saxon fallacy. You know, you won't find this in Greece, you won't find this in Italy, you won't find this in this confusion in Spain. But this is, you know, beautifully illustrated by the Gestapo, by the SS in general. You know, Himmler once delivered a very important speech, one of his major policy speeches to the Gestapo, the SS, was that they must never enjoy the death of the Jews in the camps. They must never get off on it. They must never get emotionally excited by it. They must view it calmly and without feeling.
Did in fact have an experience where he felt like he met God and God talked to him in such a way that he worried about it, because he thought, well, de facto, anybody who thinks that they met God is crazy, so I'm in trouble even feeling this. But at the same time, damn it, I believe it.
Phil, at that time in February and March of 74, had a lot of different things going on in his life. He had a lot of anxiety and stress about some anti-war activities that he had been engaged in, and he was afraid the authorities were going to come and get him. He had engaged in an orthomolecular vitamin program, a mega vitamin program, where he had taken massive amounts of vitamins, and that was really hot therapy in the 70s. So he was taking a lot of B vitamins, which make your mind race. He was also getting his wisdom teeth removed, so he was getting regular sodium pentothal injections. So he had all this stuff going on at once. What he said was five plot lines going on at once. And then one day he came home from the dentist. He had a sodium pentothal injection, and he had called the local pharmacy and asked them to deliver whatever painkillers it was that he was supposed to get. When the young lady arrived from the pharmacy with his prescription, he opened the door, and to this enormously bright light that was outside his house, and he noticed that this woman had a little Christian fish on her necklace,
which he later claimed he experienced a pink beam flowing from that to his third eye. And you know, that sounds preposterous, but I don't dismiss it, because, for instance, Jakob Böhme, who was this great German mystic, experienced, you know, a revelation from the flashing of light on a pewter dish. And he was just a shoemaker, and, you know, it's an ordinary pewter dish, but Yeah, I think it's possible to trigger profound inner experiences just from some outside stimulus that may seem random, but for whatever reason, you know, it throws the unconscious into a very deep reverie or a visionary state.
I'm so sorry that I never got any respect for religious beliefs until long after Phil passed away, because that was an area where I really, I mean, if I didn't like Paul remembering the essence, I mean, you can imagine how I felt about the pink beam. It was just like, ugh! but now I can dig it. So, and I can see, I mean, I've never had any pink beams or anything, and I don't even know whether he did or whether it was a dream, but I'm open to the idea that it could have happened now, and I'm sorry I can't tell him that and talk to him about it.
He was convinced that aliens had contacted the Russians, that they were working in collaboration to boost telepathic signals somehow, organically, electronically, something, and that he just happened to be in the line of transmission. And he picked it up because of his unique mental state due to the anxiety and the orthomolecular vitamins and the sodium pentothal and God knows what else was going on then. And this is just one theory that he had. I sound crazy saying it, but this is one of many theories that Phil developed about what happened on that 24-hour period in which he was just completely out of it. Maybe it was a mystic experience. Maybe it was a stroke, you know, an early stroke like the ones that later killed him. Maybe it was just some reaction to the combination of drugs that he took. On the other hand, maybe it was the Russians fooling around with the aliens, beaming telepathic transmissions of works of art, and Phil just happened to be in the way of the beam. We don't know.
And the reason why the idea of extraterrestrials communicating with one occurred to him is that is one of the things that he'd been talking about with me and other people for years. We were speculating, how would an extraterrestrial converse with us if the extraterrestrial had a desire to do so? And let's see, there was one writer who also had a similar experience we both knew. He wrote the Illuminati trilogy. That's it. Robert Anton Wilson had an experience of an extraterrestrial communicating with him before that. And he was living in the Bay Area at that time, and he told Phil and I about that. And Phil was mightily impressed. He said, you know, I wish they'd communicate with me.
My feeling about the whole thing was that Phil was questioning me about my experiences in an attempt to decide how crazy I was. And I think his attitude was, if he decided I was crazy, then that meant he was crazy too. But if he thought maybe I was sane, that meant maybe he was sane too. I think that was what it was really all about.
Very interesting.
I seem to have passed muster. He seems to have considered me sane, and I think that cheered him up in considering the possibility that he might be sane too.
I think that's a key point to realize about mystical transformations, is that whereas the New Age and self-improvement, self-help movements tend to portray spiritual experiences and spirituality as everything, you know, smoothly gets better, your life comes together, you become less stressed out, and, you know, it's sort of viewed as this ever more positive thing. In real life, most people who have breakthroughs of expanded consciousness, it's totally disruptive of their life, and it's destabilizing of their personality.
Phil speculated a lot upon the information that came through the pink beam. And among the things that he thought the beam had done is he thought that it had given him a warning that permitted him to, he discovered that his kid had some kind of an illness the doctors hadn't diagnosed, and that he insisted that they make additional tests so that they found what was wrong with the kid and they were able to cure him. And that was only one of a whole list of things which he said, this proves that whatever is communicating with me does know things that I don't know. And since it knows things that I don't know, it's not just me.
There's so many details that cluster around this experience or those experiences that in order to take them seriously, you almost need to, you know, have the whole story. You need to hear all the facts. Because you hear one or two, you can dismiss them easily. But when they start to mount up and interrelate, then you begin to suspect that there's some kind of guiding intelligence behind all of this odd phenomena, even if the guiding intelligence was Phil's. You know? And I know exactly how he must have felt, because I had similar things happen to me, years later. And unless you can sit someone down and tell them all the details and build up a coherent story, you don't have a chance of being taken seriously. And that's why Phil was kind of dismissed as a crank and a nut and somebody who'd gone mad by people who only heard parts of the story. Since there is no real answer to this mystery, then a lot of the different theories that he came up with and tried out do sound kind of crazy, you know? On the other hand, you just never know.
Whether or not you can prove the exact meaning of something or the exact existence of something that you can't see doesn't have anything to do with whether or not it's real. As the very same Walter Breen once said, I've never been to Hawaii, but it isn't a matter of whether or not I believe in it.
The pink beam experience did represent a shift in consciousness, a sort of breakthrough into a wider consciousness. And I think what goes in, you could call that gnosis, you know, sort of spiritual knowing. But what usually happens with people when they have gnosis or a taste of gnosis all too often is that they try to render that into some profound explanation. You know, it's like their rational mind takes hold of it and they decide, okay, I've had, you know, the cosmic breakthrough, and now I'm going to tell the rest of the world the truth, you know. And publishing Gnosis magazine, we would always be receiving these manuscripts and diagrams and whatnot from people who, I had to say, you know, had some genuine epiphany of some sort. But then they were, you know, determined to, like, figure it out, you know, with a geometric diagram of hexagons and, you know, and they're like impossible to have anybody else understand what the hell they were talking about, you know.
Voltaire, who's one of my heroes, Voltaire admired Confucius greatly, and one of the reasons he gave was Confucius was the first man in history who didn't have a divine experience. Well, that's funny enough, and I agree with it, but people who have had divine experiences, I judge them by how sane they remain after it. And I think Phil remained quite sane. He didn't get hung up on any system of dogma, fanaticism, and he didn't set out to correct his friend's morals and so on.
He began to say a lot of really weird things after the bomb thing, and a lot of speculations about what they would want with the possessions of a near hack writer, and were there some things that man was not meant to know? And he said, perhaps there is a letter that if you read it, you will die, because it contains those things that man was not meant to know. And that phrase comes from a story by H.P. Lovecraft. H.P. Lovecraft thought that there were, or anyway, he wrote about the elder gods who were demonic deities that were so weird and so different from us that just to know about them would drive you insane. There was supposed to be a book by a mad Arab that if you read it, you would emerge a gibbering maniac. And Phil thought that if something like that could be condensed down into a letter, that would be the letter that would be bound to arrive at his address.
My God, I never thought of this before. A lot of his things sound like he was part of the MK Ultra program and never figured it out. The CIA was giving LSD to people under the worst possible circumstances. They produced some memorable paranoid freakouts and a couple of suicides. They had to pay millions of dollars in damage eventually when this was uncovered. And a lot of Phil Dick's novels, besides being great science fiction, they can be read as extrasensory perception, if you assume Phil wasn't part of the experiment, that he somehow was picking up on the fact there were evil people doing evil things with drugs to evil people's minds, you know, and he was trying to figure out what would it feel like if they did it to me, and that's where a lot of his novels could have come from.
The biggest single way that the events of February, March 1974 affected Philip K. Dick's daily living is that for the rest of his life, which is another 8 years. He didn't write very much science fiction, but he wrote a lot of what he called his exegesis. And his exegesis can be accurately described as being notes to himself about what happened to him in February and March of 1974.
And, you know, of course, my reaction was the same as every Phil Dick fan's. I have to read that. You know, this is where he put the real facts. Everything else was fiction. This is where he put the reality. I must get a hold of that. And, you know, once it was edited and published, I did read it quite thoroughly and was more and more impressed with Phil's insights as a philosopher and his work as a philosopher. I mean, here's a man who read all the great philosophers. He did what the intellectuals are supposed to do. You know, he read, to make himself a writer, he read the great writers and digested what made them great and put that in his works. To become a philosopher, he read the great philosophers and thought their theories over in his own mind and made his own conclusions about them and came up with his own decisions and his own philosophies.
I like the exegesis because it doesn't offer one explanation. I don't like mystical and religious writings in general because they sound too damn dogmatic about things that nobody knows enough to be dogmatic about. And Phil realized that in trying to understand his own mystical experiences or whatever they were. He tried on a variety of different theories, and I like that, and I find it fascinating. The only other mystical writer I can think of who had that quality was Aleister Crowley, interestingly enough. No, I don't know if anybody's ever compared Phil Dick and Aleister Crowley, but they both fascinate me because they don't settle on any one explanation. They just say, if certain things happen, you'll have certain perceptions. Here's a variety of theories about why you're having these perceptions.
Exegesis, as I understand it, was a body of writing that he began to do almost compulsively following the 2374 incidents, where he was trying to figure out, okay, what's going on in my life? What's happening here? You know, things seem to be of great import. What could that be? And he sat down every night and wrote out in longhand, you know, in all these stack of paper this high, you know, different theories about it.
It was the central obsession of his life throughout that whole period. He really stopped writing anything else at that point. And what he did write that was publishable was heavily influenced by that. It was lightly fictionalized versions of the same thing. And it was sort of like Tolkien and the Silmarillion. The Silmarillion was eventually published, but it was never intended to be published. It was just the spinning out of all the ideas that had to do with hobbits. And Phil was writing out something like a Silmarillion of the Phil Dick universe in this thing. He had the idea, among other ideas about it, he thought that if he could rationalize this experience and the subsequent events when it seemed that the voice had planted knowledge in his mind which he had not any other way of knowing, if he could rationalize that, then he would contribute to the human race's sum of knowledge by discovering a new source of knowledge. And at other times he says, what a great supply for plots. So whether he actually believed that he was communicated by anybody, I think sometimes he did and sometimes he didn't. And sometimes he believed it so that it was a central obsession of his life. And sometimes he thought, I must be nuts.
Here we are in on San Pablo Avenue in Berkeley. We're just about four or five blocks down from a house where Phil lived on Francisco Street during the 50s. At the time, he was writing a tremendous amount of short stories and writing some novels, actually some of them about this area. And in the introduction to The Golden Man, he tells this grim story about coming to this pet shop and buying horse meat, which was intended for dogs, I don't know, maybe cats. He had a bunch of cats, I know. But the owner of the store at some point called him on it and said, you know, you're eating this for your, this, you know, you're eating this stuff. This is, but, you know, I guess he was poor and that's, you know, that's what it came to. But
writing the Lucky Dog Pet Food Store essay, in effect, with the help of feedback from his agent, Russ Galen, gave Phil answer to a question he'd been wrestling with for years, which was how to write a novel about these pivotal experiences that he had in February and March of 1974. And writing that essay and getting good response to it from his agent made him see that there was another way that he, Philip K. Dick, could write such a novel. And so the Lucky Dog Pet Food Store essay leads directly to Vallis.
After having sent my ship of inquiry out into the universe to find out the mysteries of the universe, the ship comes back finally after 26 years and says, the greatest mystery in the universe is the human brain. And then I say, and what is the answer to the mystery is? And well, I just said it's the greatest mystery. And all I have learned is where the greatest mystery of the universe is located. It's in between our left ear and our right ear. It's just an incredible thing. It's like, you know, I know, I've read, I'm sure this is true, there are more possible connections in Hewitt circuitry in the brain than there are stars in the universe. And that should tip you off right there. But what if somebody said, what have you learned in, you know, these 26 years of writing and say, you know, over and over again, ask what is reality? I said, well, I've learned that I don't understand the human brain, but man, do I have my heart.
I miss him. I just plain miss him. I've rarely gone a day without missing him in all this time.
When a close friend dies, I find that what I miss and remember is the voice. Just that's the personification of that person, you know, that now you don't get any more phone calls where, hey, Paul, this is Phil, you know, and that particular voice. So it's like contained within the textures of the voice is so much of our relationship and my sense of him as a person and as a friend.
What I miss most about him is just his intensity. You know, the guy was just, you know, he would he was so present. He had such a presence that you really knew you were with a human being when you talked to Phil. And he was, for his failures, I think, kept him humble. His successes fueled him to look deeper into the subjects he was interested in, like what is reality and who's really real. And if he liked you, you felt like you had a friend. You know, you knew that this was a good guy and you could trust him. And he would give up his life for you if he had to. He just had that kind of presence. And I miss that.
When he was living in Oakland, I would see him every other day, sometimes every day. And we would have long talks about every conceivable subject. And I always remember laughing so that I was actually in pain when I left. I'd laugh so much that my jaw ached, because he was easily the funniest person that I've ever met, including, and I've known some people who were funny professionally and got to be famous for being funny. But they were not as funny as Phil was when he was in a relaxed mood. I think that there was only a small distance between the synapses in his brain so that thoughts could leap from one subject to an entirely different subject and make some pretense of a connection between those thoughts, no matter how far they were from each other.
In my meetings with him, I always got the impression of a warm, intelligent, nice person. Friendly person. I never got the impression of any sort of fanaticism or lack of emotional stability. I know Phil was emotionally unstable at times, but it was not. It did not seem to me that he was the type of person that I wanted to avoid. He was the type of person I wish I had seen a lot more of. I could deal with this kind of instability better than a lot of the other kinds that are around in our society.
I think what goes on in many cases with great mystics who experience a sense of unity of the universe and sort of belonging, of union, is sort of like a reverse paranoia. You know, instead of the unseen forces are ranged against me and they're trying to do something to me, which is sort of like the classic paranoid perspective. I think what occurs with a mystical experience is like a positive paranoia, you know, that the unseen forces are there, but it's basically benign, and that ultimately is going to work out. Ultimately, there's a sense to everything, and you know, it all is coming together. And, you know, I think Phil Dick was right on the edge between those two things. You know, he had had a life of what you could call negative paranoia. You know, he had the epiphany with the pink beam. And then I think he was struggling with, is there a positive paranoia, or, you know, is it negative? And, you know, much of the exegesis, much of what he was thinking about, you know, was, oh, the forces are against me, you know, I'm battling the KGB, or, you know, my mind is being invaded by the satellite or whatever. But ultimately, it seemed to me, and you can see this with Divine Invasion and Timothy Archer, you know, I mean, ultimately, I think he came to a peace, you know, a positive take on things.
An interesting one is the Three Stick Man, as far as I'm concerned, is that I have read that and had the distinct impression that it was an extraordinary book. In fact, so extraordinary that it may have no peer. It may be a unique book in the history of writing, but nothing was ever done like it. And then I've read it over, and I thought it was just completely crazy. It's just, I mean, that it was just an insane book that was not about, it was not about insanity, it was insanity. We'll be right back.
science fiction world has an acceptance and a fraternity that doesn't exist in any other literary genre, and probably doesn't exist anywhere else except in a religious order of some kind. That's the only thing I can compare it to. But it's better than that, because you don't have to believe in anything, and you don't have to accept anybody as your leader to be a science fiction fan. So I cannot imagine Philip K. Dick existing anywhere else.
Since I have the experience of having been the editor of the Philip K. Dick Society newsletter, so I've read a lot of letters from people, and I still get them now, who want to get information about the newsletter because Philip K. Dick's books mean so much to them. And then in these letters, they often want to testify as though this was some kind of religious cult or something.
I made a website about a year ago through my tribute to Philip K. Dick. It's called PKD Slept Here. And what I wanted to do was, when I moved out to Berkeley and realized that Philip K. Dick lived essentially for a long time in my neighborhood, and I just thought it would be neat to take photos of all these places he lived. And the original idea was just going to be, I was going to call it something like Philip K. Dick's Berkeley or something like that, and do a whole history of, I wanted to take photos of the high school and the college and all this kind of stuff. But through reading Lawrence Sutton's biography, I realized that he lived all over this area. So my girlfriend and I, just for about a month, we went probably every weekend for a day. We took a little road trip, and we went to Sonoma, we went to Point Reyes Station and different parts of Oakland and Berkeley with the digital camera, and took photos of all this stuff. And basically that's the basis of the website, is photos of places where he lived. I guess the inspiration for the website was when I was, this was a long time ago, but I was a student in Russia and living in St. Petersburg and studying in a place called Pushkin House, which is kind of like the literary, it's basically the center of literary scholarship on Pushkin. And, you know, they just love Pushkin in Russia, even if it's all about Pushkin, it's still all about Pushkin for them. And so we'd have classes in the morning, and then in the afternoon they'd put us on a bus, and we'd drive around St. Petersburg to all these literary sites. They call them Dome Musée, which is a house museum. And it's like, you know, Pushkin lived here for a little while, and here's his desk, and this is the lamp, and, you know, here's one of his pens, and when he was here, he wrote this, and the whole thing is done, you know, meticulously maintained. It's almost like they have the cult of Lenin, and they do this with the communist leaders too, some of those guys. And it was just really, I don't know, it was pretty fascinating for me, because they, you know, maybe Pushkin lived in this apartment for 2 weeks during one summer for some obscure reason, but just that fact alone that he was there for 2 weeks was enough to justify the expense of maintaining a whole house just dedicated to those 2 weeks.
When people come to visit philipkdick.com, they're going to find a huge library of resources and commentary and interviews about the author. Not just about the author, but also his ideas. We have artwork contributed by fans from all over the world that some of it is based on his novels, some of it is just based on the abstract ideas that he wrote about. And the site is an opportunity for artists and writers and other creative people to share their own vision with other fans who can appreciate that kind of artwork and that kind of thinking. What I've found as I've met people through the website is that many of us have a lot of the same ideas about the world, about politics, about you know, the world we live in, and our attitude towards things tends to be really similar. And that's a great connection that I feel that we've made through the site with all the people that have contributed stuff. So here's some of the things that we have there. We have real audio interviews with Philip K. Dick. We have programs about him that you can listen to in streaming audio. We have tons of literary criticism of his work for people that are looking to further their intellectual study of Philip K. Dick. There's an endless amount of reading material there, that's for sure. We have a huge art gallery of original artwork. We have a few hundred scans of all the covers of his books, and people send me that stuff all the time to work to stay on top of it, so we get all that kind of stuff. And one guy even gave me a 200-page website about Philip K. Dick that he's been building for 10 years on his own computer, hasn't shared it with the world, and we're just getting ready to turn it on right now. So there's hundreds more pages of history and you know, commentary and news about the author, and that's really cool. One of my favorite sections of the site is the Philip K. Dick's Hollywood section, which is one that I built in conjunction with some other folks on the web. And what it is a list of movies that we think, you know, are written, are in the spirit of Philip K. Dick, that may have been influenced by him in many ways. We have a list of, you know, maybe like 50 of them that many people have heard of, and some that they haven't. And that's a really cool way to look at it.
I think the greatest thing about Phil Dick was that he was a genius. You know, I think the greatest thing about Phil Dick was that he endured misery and poverty and being ignored by the literary community, and yet persisted in creating great art. I think that's the greatest thing about Phil Dick.
That particular unique personality that is Philip K. Dick arises when you and I, the three of us, or any two or three readers of Philip K. Dick or friends of his or whatever get together, then we have the opportunity, as in the ends of those stories, to actually experience his presence. And it's uniquely him. And I appreciate that, and I appreciate in that way that I still have him in my life. And that's definitely quite a gift.
I think it's quite possible that if you were in an earlier era and had similar experiences, that a religion might have built up around him. You know, he could have become a prophet of a sort. I mean, there's also the parallels with Joseph Smith of the Mormon Church, you know, seemingly, supposedly contacted by angels and channels, for any better word, you know, the whole Book of Mormon in the space of 3 months, I think it is, you know, and he himself was supposedly semi-literate. Well, there's any possible number of explanations for what went on there, but it turned into a you know, enormous world religion, and it's probably just as well that we don't have the Church of Phil Dick or something like that, you know, because there's enough wacko details to what he experienced that I'd rather not, you know, believe that there's a satellite up there beaming information at us and the rest of it. But I think it would be quite possible in an earlier, perhaps a little less skeptical era, that he would have triggered a whole religion. And who knows? You know, check in 100 years from now and we'll see. It may yet happen. We'll be right back.
And that, my friends, is the gospel according to Philip K. Dick. More or less.